Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to North Shore Live Cooper's Corner. We're live this evening. This is May 4th. This is the first Wednesday of the month, and I hope your day was wonderful. Weather was a little cloudy, but I suppose better than snow, it's okay. Hope everybody is well and that you're able to get out a little bit. Not so much cabin fever, and the malls are just waiting for you to walk their areas. Anyway, we have a wonderful program for you, and we hope that you will enjoy it because my guests are outstanding. This evening, we have the pleasure and honor of having for a long time a wonderful, upstanding citizen and resident here of Highland Park, 12-year former mayor of Highland Park, Mayor Dan Pierce. Welcome, Mayor Pierce, to the program.
Oh, thank you, Bev.
My pleasure to have you here.
It's an honor to be here again after your many decades broadcasting to the people of Highland Park, which you're very fortunate to have had. And I think I was with you when I was in the state legislature.
That's right.
And I know I was with you several times in my 12 years as
That's
mayor.
That's right, running
of
for
Highland
mayor.
Park.
That's right.
And now that I've retired from those posts and I'm a trustee and president of the North Shore Water Reclamation District.
Water Reclamation.
It's a new phase in my senior years.
Well, listen, we just keep moving on to bigger and better things, Dan, you know. And we're so pleased that you're able to come and give us some input on what's going on in Springfield. Because people up here, you know, we're kind of detached because unless you are a part of the experience of Springfield, you don't know. So please tell our viewers what we're supposed to expect from Springfield for the state of Illinois.
Because, well, yes, what's done in Springfield does affect us, our schools, our city government, and our daily life in Highland Park, Lake County, Lake Forest, and wherever you're we're being watched this evening. And it's very upsetting to me what's going on there, because I believe in state government, I believe in federalism, and I believe the state and locality should be the ones that are determining our educational priorities, as well as, of course, public safety and so on. And now we're at a stalemate. Fortunately, although we've had no budget this year, our fiscal year, the current year, which ends June 30th of this year, 2016, fiscal 2016, we have no state budget. And how we operate is ad hoc. They did pass a budget for the public schools, elementary and high schools, not for the universities. So this year, the universities were about ready to close. And they passed a stopgap bill that the governor signed a few weeks ago that will carry them through the summer. But the sad thing is the new fiscal year starts July 1st, and how can they plan when they don't even know what it was for this year? That by court order, salaries have been paid to state employees and to others, but people like social services are unpaid. The medical is being reimbursed 9 months or a year later for employees.
That's terrible.
And there's so many gaps in what the state should pay and doesn't pay. Municipalities, of course, receive their own sales tax funds. So far, so good, but that can stop. So it's a sad situation, and it's split government, but we're used to split government.
Well, but Dan, first of all, the kids have got to go to school. The colleges have to open for those that have graduated from the high school and are anticipating their first year in college, even if it's a local, CLC or a junior college. But if the schools aren't going to be open and the teachers aren't going to be paid, then what happens? What are we falling into?
We've never had this before. A serious thing is the MAPS program, which provides state aid for students who can't afford college, and that goes all the way from the University of Illinois and Illinois State and Northern Illinois and so on to private colleges like Lake Forest College and others where the students, that aid hasn't been paid this year for the students, and so the colleges had to absorb that, pay that, so they could pay their teachers and other employees, and that was okay for 1 year. They got by, but they can't get by for two. It's a crisis, and it's caused by, we know we have a governor of one party and a General Assembly, House and Senate, of the other party, and that's happened before. It's nothing new, but this time we had kind of stubborn leadership that won't won't compromise. It's the fault of both parties. I'm not going to be at all partisan on this subject.
Sure.
It's a problem of the governor and a problem of the legislature. And the leaders who are mature people should be able to come to some way of governing the state, and so far they haven't.
Well, what about the power of the people? I mean, if the people contact their legislators, isn't that some kind of a movement that would get them to understand that the kids have got to be in school and the schools have got to be open, the teachers have to be paid? If there's more direction to the legislators, can't they bring that to the floor and say, listen, my people in my district want and demand to have a school that's open and their teachers be paid? Why can't conversation be made on that?
Well, so far, the elementary and secondary schools, as I said, have been an exception, and that budget passed, but it's way below what is needed. And now the universities will be open through the summer. The problem is, the House and Senate pass a bill. The governor says that's not what he wants.
So they veto it.
And he vetoes it.
Oh.
And sometimes they override it. Sometimes they can't. And the governor said, before we have a budget, we've got to solve some problems that I think are hurting Illinois business. He's got some proposals for redistricting. He's got some proposals for term limits. He's got some proposals that hurt unions. Some proposals that affect plaintiffs in litigation. So, and he says that program has to be enacted before I will approve any appropriation, with exception of a few exceptions. So that's why the schools are still open today. But that could come to an end, and so. It's a situation that exists in no other state. None of the other 49 states have a situation where they haven't got a budget for fiscal 2016.
And why is that? Why is Illinois, really, this is not a joke, Illinois is horrific with doing things like this. They put the people on hold. The kids on hold, families on hold, everybody's on hold, and nothing is even discussed appropriately in a timely fashion to be able to keep things moving. It's like a wheel. Dan, you got to keep the wheel moving. You got to keep it oiled. You got to keep it, because these people are expecting to be reelected. Excuse me.
Yeah.
That doesn't happen. If my legislator in my district doesn't perform the duties that they're supposed to do and keep us at bay because we don't have jobs, or the kids aren't in school, or teachers aren't being paid, and there's on strike, the school strikes, the teacher strikes. Do you think I'm going to reelect that person?
Right. Well, the problem is there's no governor's election this year. It's not for 2 years.
I know.
The legislators themselves, because of districting, many are in very safe districts, and they'll argue, everyone's pointing the finger each other, they'll argue, well, we passed a bill, and the governor vetoed it.
It doesn't
and
get implemented.
The governor says it wasn't balanced, it didn't meet the constitutional requirements of being a balanced budget, and they say, well, let's find new revenues, and you have to do two things. You have to cut expenditures and increase revenues, and no one is willing to stick their neck out. Our income tax now is lower than it was 2 years ago. It expired.
But it's still bad.
It's lower. We have the highest real estate taxes,
oh,
but we have the lowest, among the lowest income taxes of any state. And so where do you look for money? The unemployed can't pay it. Those who work and have an income.
Yeah, but look at the pay scale. It's only like $8 an hour. How are you going to slap them with it? But listen, those people are willing to work. It doesn't make a difference. Whatever, they want a job, they want to provide for their families. But if you're going to sack it to them with a high increase in their tax, in their real estate tax, they might as well not work and collect unemployment, or wait, better yet, collect social, the food stamps and welfare. I mean, my goodness sakes.
Well, most people would rather work, but there's some that do what you say. But the problem is they can't live on, as you say, they can't live on the $8 or $9 or $10 an hour.
No, that's right.
And it's not only education, but social workers that help home health care workers.
Yeah.
They're still working, but they're not being paid. All these agencies that provide, you know, all the state work is not done through state agencies. They use agencies like Catholic Charities and other agencies to provide the home health care, the care for seniors, for the disabled.
Yep, yep.
Those people are still going to work. They haven't been paid, and their agencies haven't been paid in months.
And so how do they live? They have bills.
They have to go on, you know, public aid.
Public aid.
And the agencies have to close down. Some agencies have closed down or announced they will be closing down in a month or two. So it's a crisis, and somehow the newspapers try to let you know, but it still hasn't caught on with the public. There's a complete crisis. Now, who can solve it? It's got to start with leadership. People are leaders in order to solve crises.
Well, that's why we voted them in office.
And that's the legislative leaders.
That's why we voted them in office to be leaders. But they're not leading. They're not giving direction. And the public, really, you're going to hear an outcry from the public very shortly. They can only take so much. You know, you just can't squeeze any more blood out of the stone. It doesn't work anymore.
The other states have problems, but none as severe as Illinois, because we have no budget. We don't know what.
We have no leadership.
And we can't print money. You know, the federal government can go sell bonds or print money. States can't print money. And now our credit rating in Illinois, as well as the city of Chicago, have gone down to just one step above junk status.
Oh, my.
And so people, when you sell a bond, you've got to pay a heck of a lot of interest.
Sure.
And pretty soon they won't be able to sell bonds. There are 50 states to buy bonds from. Who's going to buy
Illinois
bonds?
Oh, no, no. They steer clear of Illinois.
And the same with the city of Chicago, which is deeply in debt.
Terrible.
And probably worse than most communities in the country. Not in bankruptcy yet.
Well, the city of Chicago is a state all by itself. You know, my goodness sakes, how many people they have in the city? 4 or 5 million people just in the city of Chicago. Then if you have to deal with the state on top of the problems that the city is having, that's monumental, monumental. Everybody gets socked with some problems that you're infusing more heartache on families that want to get ahead and are trying to get ahead, but there's no path to get ahead.
Well, I'll say this. I have to compliment some public officials. The city of Highland Park has maintained its AAA bond rating, and so have other communities, Lake Forest, and so on. I know you have many listeners there.
Yes, viewers, yes.
And Deerfield and so on.
Yeah.
But that's going to be a problem pretty soon, because the state may be withholding payments that are due to local governments. The state collects local sales taxes, local personal property replacement tax, and then reimburses the localities. But now they're having trouble doing that. They may slow down on that. They're asking for big refunds of the personal property replacement tax. So this is starting at the top and filtering down. It didn't start at the bottom.
Come up, yeah.
But it started at the top and filtering down. So I'm trying to think of some good news for you.
Good news would be more than welcome. Oh, my goodness sakes. But this is real news. I mean, this is today's news. And we need some good news to hear.
In the state of Illinois, you know, University of Illinois is a very fine school. But if you're a young professor who wants to transfer from a smaller school and to a larger,
large university,
more prosperous university, you have 50 state universities to choose from. And Illinois, you'd think, would be one you'd cherished a few years ago, and now you would be hesitant because there'd certainly be no raises, and they're operating at a deficit. And so not only U of I, but all the other schools, Northern, Southern,
sure.
Eastern Illinois State, and the private colleges who receive MAP money for poor students' tuitions, that's not coming through. So it's a, now it will for a year.
But where is the good news, Dan?
Yeah.
I mean,
The good news is, I think, we've got healthy, hardworking people in our state. You go down to Chicago, you see buildings being built.
I see.
They're building
this.
Hotels.
Okay, but they've got
office buildings.
You got to pay the construction workers.
That's private, of course. Yeah. Someone must think that Chicago and Illinois has a future, but it's hard to see a way. Excuse me. It's hard to see a way out of this.
Well, you know, for the longest time, I've always thought that government, in specifically in the health care situation. Many times I've been in Springfield dealing with the Department of Mental Health. I'm one of the founding members of the Alliance for the Mentally Ill some 37 years ago, a long time, and which is now NAMI, the National Alliance for the Mentally Ill. And, you know, we want to help those citizens that are in need of psychiatric care. And when we went down to visit Elgin, we went for the holidays, we went during Easter, we went during Christmas, giving gifts, bringing things to people. And I mean, I don't know them, but I'm certainly there to offer my assistance and whatever I can do to help them. But a number of them are like there. They're just there. Their families have unfortunately passed away. There's nowhere for them to go. Healthcare is not being treated appropriately. I don't know if they even know what's happening with them, but we need to be able to pay those that are there helping the most vulnerable, which are those that are disabled, mentally disabled, or physically disabled. And I don't know where it all goes. Where does the money go, Dan?
Well,
from
some people are still being paid and working, but there's no additional. There's a complete hiring freeze on the state, and as people retire, they're not replaced. And a lot of these are low-paid people, home health care workers, people that work with the disabled, the seniors. And so on. So I agree with you, the public is going to arise.
Oh boy.
Unfortunately, they can't do much at the governor's level because that election isn't until 2018.
I know, but somebody's got to.
The legislature, though, is half of the state Senate and all of the House are up for re-election.
They're up for election.
In November.
Okay, so do you think that. Residents like here in Highland Park are going to re-elect those that have not done anything to be able to protect their own district, the people in their district, from higher wages, higher taxes that they're not getting even appropriate wage to be able to. I mean, this is ridiculous. And they're senior citizens. What are we going to do for our senior citizens? We need laws, and we need them to be enforced. We cannot allow the senior citizens to be assaulted, abused, extorted, anything. I mean, these are people that need assistance when they need it, not threatened by other agencies not to make any complaints. This is ridiculous. Really ridiculous. We're going to be honoring all this month the American Legion and all those that have served, all the veterans that have served, because May I'm making specifically for veterans.
Mm-hmm.
And so
I know you do wonderful work with veterans.
And I mean, what a wonderful group of human beings. That's part of the generation, the best generation. I mean, because they gave, these are World War II, you know that,
Korean War.
Korean War, absolutely. All those conflicts. And these people are being, overlooked or not even cared for it appropriately. And that is very disturbing to me, since we have a household of two combat veterans, and Kenny wasn't in combat, but he's still a veteran from the Navy Air Force. So I've got three veterans in my household, and we don't see any care that really should be taking place for the veterans that have come back from Iraq or some from Vietnam. I'm on the advisory board for the veterans out of Lake County. It's just pathetic, really pathetic.
Well, we're fortunate in that we are close to the North Chicago Veterans Hospital.
Oh, yeah.
And they're trying.
Great Lakes, right.
It's at Great Lakes, but there's a Veteran Hospital and Great Lakes have merged.
Yeah.
The Naval Hospital and the Veterans Hospital have merged into one. It's the first place in the country where they've merged into one operating hospital named after the great astronaut Lovell from
Lake Forest. Jim Lovell. I know Jim Lovell. I got pictures of him.
And they've named that hospital instead of North Chicago Veterans Hospital or Great Lakes Navy Hospital. It's all called the Captain Jim Lovell.
That's right.
Hospital, medical center. And it's associated with the medical school up there too, Chicago Med. So that's, and they're trying, they're doing what they can. The Highland Park American Legion Post 145 that I belong to and am on the executive committee as their judge advocate. We're gonna have our usual Poppy Day here in a couple of weeks.
Yeah.
Where all the money collected at the different grocery stores like Sunset and Jewel, when you see them holding them, those will go directly to services in North Chicago at the Lovell Medical Center that aren't provided for by the government.
Okay.
And incidentals and so on that aren't provided. And that's in our auxiliary of our American Legion. And I think you're going to have the commander.
Yes, yes. And I'm trying desperately to get Tammy Duckworth on here because Tammy, a wonderful, I mean, she's a congressman now. I think she's running for Senate.
Oh, yeah, she's running for Senate in November.
And, yes, and she lost both legs and a partial arm. And when I contacted Tammy previously, she was just on maternity leave. She had just had Abigail, the baby. So, but, you know, we went around the program. She is wonderful. She was a helicopter pilot.
Yeah,
and that was
she's
she's done a wonderful job. The public needs to know and see our veterans and how they just don't give up. They will not give up because they want to try for America to be able to help others. And so now she wants to go into the Senate because, Dan, she has experience, life experience.
Yeah, well, she won the primary, Democrat primary. So she'll be on the ballot in November, and that'll be for the full six-year term.
Yeah.
She's been elected, I think, two or three times to the House of Representatives in Congress. And I'll try to help you. I'll try to help you get her on the
Tammy
show.
Duckworth, and you're more than welcome to come back on with her because Tammy needs, the public needs to see her. Wonderful lady who gave the ultimate, I mean, the limbs from her body for America. She was a helicopter pilot, and she's a wonderful human being, and nothing can keep her down. And you need to see with your own eyes the miraculous human being that she is. When you say veteran, I don't just mean somebody who's got a title because they sit behind a desk and push a pencil, but never go into combat. She is a combat veteran, and my hat goes off to her, and we're doing all we can. We want to let the public
see her. I support her in the primary.
Absolutely.
So I had a chance to meet with her several times, and I'll try to...
Good. Get her on. All the accolades to you, Dan. Everybody's watching and hearing. All the accolades to you.
On good old Channel 19.
Yes, that's correct. She's terrific. The help maybe with having a veteran in that situation, in that office as a senator, a U.S. senator, may provoke some interest with the rest of the public. I mean, who knows better about what's going on than those who have lived in that situation? You can't read this stuff from a book, Dan. No. You can't. And you can't make it from a book. This is real life. She can tell her experiences, which is immeasurable, immeasurable.
Well, I certainly hope you can land her on the show. Yeah. You know, she's running statewide. It's a big state.
Absolutely.
And I think she'd be pleased to find time. She's got to be in Congress when Congress is in session, because she still is a member of the House of Representatives in Washington. But she's a wonderful person. Now, on the November election, I think it's up to the voters to look at the records of our particular representatives in Springfield. I know from the Highland Park and Lake Forest area, we have Representative Scott Drury, who's the fourth chair in the area of Highwood.
Julie Morrison.
And then we have State Senator Julie Morrison, who lives in Deerfield but serves Highland Park and Lake Forest.
That's right, 29th District, yeah.
And so look at their records, and I think you'll come to your own decision. I'm not here to politicize today.
But you see what they've accomplished for the public, and that's the whole idea.
And they'll come on your show, I tell you.
Absolutely, absolutely, without a problem, without a problem.
Have you had them before?
Julie, I think, was on when we were in the old studio.
Yeah.
This is new. Dan, we're new here. I think it's 5 years.
Very nice.
Yes, it's beautiful. Beautiful here. We've moved, I don't know how many times, I think 6 times. Here, there, wherever, but we're still here. Yeah. We go live. I'm the only one that was grandfathered in. And when they changed the location from the other studio to here.
Your old studio was up on Skokie Highway.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah, that's correct.
Two different places, I think.
But we go back all the way to the one on Central Avenue next to the post office.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, and so, and then we were in Wilmette or Winnetka for about a year or so because the other building, the roof fell in, so we had to go there. I mean, it wasn't fun driving.
Well, I know the City Highland Park has cooperated and provided you this space.
Oh, yes, that's wonderful. Yes.
Part-time help to...
You know, the point is that we do community service. I do everything I possibly can to let the public know, introduce them to our leaders, because people at work, they husbands, wives, kids, 2 jobs, 3 jobs, they don't have time to go meet personally at a fundraiser or whatever. So this way they get to see, meet who you are, see who you are. If they want to contact you, they can contact you. This is wonderful. Dan Pierce, our former Highland Park mayor, 12 years, did a wonderful job. Great speaker, knows what he's doing, is there for the public, there for the people. And we are pleased to have him on the program. I mean, he can tell you many things about what has gone on here on Highland Park. How long have you been in Highland Park, Dan?
Well, I moved with my parents. I hate to tell you how long ago it was, but it was, I will tell you, it was 1944.
That's a long time ago. That's a while ago, babe.
The good news is Highland Park has a newly expanded water plant, so if everyone's interested in what's going on in Flint, Michigan.
Yes,
and
yes.
And we have a new state-of-the-art
that
was started under the previous mayor and finished under Mayor Nancy Rotering. And it's working fine, so our water is the best. In fact, my wife, Rhoda, tends to, like we're doing tonight, drink bottled water.
Bottled water.
And I tell her, you know, we don't know what's in that bottle, where it came from, but I know where our Highland Park water comes from, and I know it's treated. It's like Michigan water, how it's treated and inspected. And so I like to drink it right out of our Highland Park water.
It's called a Michigan Straight. You know, it's the rest Michigan Straight right out of there,
I won't say all the time what I may add to it.
Oh, well, you know.
Saturday nights.
It depends. You could any night doesn't make a difference.
Okay. I have permission, right?
It's totally up to you. After 70 years of being here, Dan, it's okay. You can add whatever you'd like.
Okay. But anyway, it goes with about anything. So we're fortunate there. The North Shore Water Reclamation District, which used to be called for 100 years the North Shore Sanitary District. And we changed our name, and I and I am a trustee, one of the five trustees representing the Highland Park Highwood area, and Tom Swarthout is representing Lake Forest and Lake Bluff, another trustee. I'm president of the board this year, and we have three wonderful water reclamation plants. They used to be called sewage treatment plants.
Yeah,
now they're water reclamation plants. One right here in Highland Park on Clavey Road, state of the art, and one in Gurnee, and one in Waukegan. And I think in India or China, some places would be glad to drink the effluent that comes from our
right.
plant.
You better believe.
We don't claim it's drinking water by U.S. standards, but it's not far from it. But that's not our aim. Our aim is, we have Lake Michigan, our aim is to find uses, reuses
yeah.
of this water before it goes down either the Skokie River or the Des Plaines River.
Yeah.
The two places where we discharge to. And so you can be very comfortable with our wastewater treatment, our sewage treatment.
Well, we know we're safe, but Flint, Michigan, that's terrible. To save money. And see, that's where politics, I don't like that idea. I mean, you have human life, that those babies have died there, they have cancer, whatever else is happening to them. You can't just say you're sorry. Sorry doesn't cover it. Sorry cannot cover it. How could he want to save money and not give the people what they're entitled to?
Well, they try to save money. Detroit, with all its problems, is a very fine water treatment plant like Chicago does. And then to save money, they said, well, we won't buy our water from Detroit. We'll go right in and
get our
own water from the Flint River. And then that wasn't so good.
That was terrible.
And then the way they set it up, the pipes started to leak lead. Oh. You got to keep the water flowing. And they didn't. And children are going to grow up there. And you won't know maybe until they're 20 or 25 years old.
That's right.
What the lead in the system has done to them. It's not apparent immediately. And so,
well, it's brain damage for sure.
It's a sad thing. But in Highland Park, fortunately, we may have problems, but that's not one of them.
I suppose you've seen a multitude of change from when it was prairie out here, because these homes were just cottages, you know. Whoever was here.
Well, the west part of Highland Park, there were still farms.
There were farms, sure.
Sure, were some. And very nice homes are today.
And yeah, where Polk Brothers, mm-hmm. they had their farm on Ridge.
22,
yeah,
Ridge 22.
That's right.
Northeast.
Yeah, that was.
Northeast of there. Yeah, there was.
We saw that come and go. Wow.
Well, that was inevitable, but there has been change. We did do something that no other suburbs have done, or very few. We saved our downtown, enhanced it, and made it downtown that other towns envy, preserving the residential character of our community. When I was mayor, I knew there were three or four things that made Highland Park different. Our proximity to Lake Michigan, our wonderful rail transportation to Chicago where commuters work, our fine schools, and our healthy residential areas. But in order to support the city, we needed healthy business too.
That's right.
We're part of the sales tax goes to city government. So it was a balanced strike between preserving the residential character of the community and enhancing and saving really the downtown. We didn't want to go the Evanston route of tall buildings, even though that's fine for itself, but we didn't want to be like Evanston, nor could we remain like a place like Kenilworth without stores, and we were too
like
a larger community. We had a history of a downtown. Highland Park always had a
downtown.
And most cities that did saw the decline of the downtown when shopping centers were built.
Sure, and those big box stores came in.
Big box stores came in and just west of us. And we were able to preserve it. Now there are, from time to time, small stores, there's vacancies, but they fill up, and we have a healthy downtown. Sometimes try to park downtown.
Oh, don't tell me. I know. Around the block. But I figured, no, I can't park on the street. And so I have to go into the garage. But the garage is wonderful.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
It's a strange thing. People are reluctant. And the garages are free.
Oh, yes. It's free. And it's wonderful in the wintertime. You pull into the garage, your car isn't loaded with snow. You know, you come in, it's dry. You can go upstairs, go wherever you have to go, and in the buildings or go outside, wherever. We have a wonderful downtown section in Highland Park. Absolutely.
Yeah, and we work hard
and people come
and not encroach on the residents' areas. Yeah, people come from all over.
You better I just took the words out of my mouth. I have a girlfriend comes from Florida, and when Highland Park has Highland Park days, she specifically comes to go shopping on the sidewalk with all the things. She loves it. She said, and she's in a wonderful area, but she said things that she has not seen are up here. I don't know where the clothes comes out of New York or California, wherever they're getting the clothes. But she's delighted, and she comes up specifically for that.
Yeah, we've worked hard to preserve that. It's interesting. When I was mayor, we found that people that would walk miles at a shopping center have their car walk around the corner in Highland Park.
See?
For some, it's psychological. They want to be in the same block as the store.
Well,
if you look at Northbrook Court sometimes where you park,
you have to
you're much
walk.
Further away.
Oh my, oh
especially
my,
at the holiday season.
Yeah.
So, but we're trying to educate people on that. Another thing I thought was humorous, you'd see shoppers, some of them women and some men, who worked out that day, ran a couple of miles and so on, but then they won't walk around the corner a block to buy their groceries or there are other essentials. It's psychological.
Well, they want to get in the car and they want to be the first car there. Right as you open the door, you walk right in.
I mean, want to see the store.
Yeah, not everybody
after
can
they've
be
just
right
jogged
there.
For two or three
that's
miles.
That's right. That's right. Exactly.
And,
so.
And,
exactly
can't, that's so. Psychological. We can't. We're trying to change it, but it's hard to change people's mindset. Meanwhile, our downtown is healthy.
We're it is very.
One of the few towns that still have a going movie theater. And and the old Highland Park Theater would still be going if the old owners had taken care of it and brought it up to date, which they did, and they let it decline to the place where it was no longer safe. And so the old Halcyon, as it was once called, Highland Park Theater, but we have a fine theater on 2nd Street that is modernized and try to keep it up with things. A new restaurant. Next
Park
door.
Clinton Square, sure.
And last evening, Belo's, the restaurant next to the theater, had a Highland Park Rotary night, and they invited the Rotary. They gave the people a 20% of what came went to the Rotary charities.
Oh, good.
And they had other incentives and showed us the restaurant. A lot of people
nice.
Said. Gee, I haven't been here
See?
Since it was Belo's.
Oh,
It's very nice. And of course, I'm not downing Highwood. I like to eat Highwood, but
Highwood.
But
terrific.
As mayor of Highland Park, I was always pushing Highland Park.
Oh, of course, this is your home turf. This is your. But you know, the restaurants are really—they're not. One doesn't knock the other because the food is just as good in one area as the other. It just depends what your taste is because other
right.
you know what they have wonderful steaks, wonderful
we have Italian restaurants, Italian, we have Mexican restaurants,
yes,
sushi
yes.
Restaurants
yes.
and even like French restaurants.
Yeah.
So that's there and the people do come. There's one thing about Highland Park people don't realize this makes it difficult. We only can draw people from three directions because of Lake Michigan.
Of east, of go
the
east
average
of,
town can drive draw
from
people
all
from
directions.
North, south,
that's right.
East
that's
and
right.
west.
That's right.
And we have no east.
That's
two blocks east of our downtown.
You can walk.
You're in the lake.
Yeah, you can go fishing right there. Okay, yeah, that's good.
So that's a problem we have, but
that's
we,
not really
we've
even
survived.
A problem because people like that. They really like that.
Yeah, my predecessors. Bob Buhai and Ray Geraci deserve a lot of credit.
Buhai.
They worked hard.
Yeah.
And Bob Buhai was really
wonderful.
Really started it.
Wonderful.
Ray continued it.
Yep.
And I continued it.
Yep.
And the mayors since have Mike Belsky and of course our current
Nancy
first
Rotary
woman mayor.
Yeah. Wasn't that something?
And Nancy Rotary's done a wonderful job. Someday maybe we'll have a first woman president, but I'm not going to be political.
Oh, here we go. You know, this gentleman said to me, I'm not going to be political tonight. And there, it popped right out of his lips.
Well, I didn't mention what party she said.
Oh, you know, right. Okay, whatever.
So anyway, someday.
Yeah, you never can tell. You never can tell.
Not necessarily next year.
Life is very strange, you know. And, you know, if, you know what they say in Chicago, if you don't like, the weather on this side, walk across the street, and the wind can still blow another direction, so you can never tell. But the first mayor of Highland Park is Nancy Rotary, and so, you know, she has now broken that glass ceiling, yeah. And so here you go.
And see? She'll have a good history ahead, not a good history, good good future ahead.
Sure.
And go on to other things, maybe larger stages. So we'll see about that.
I mean, she's very viable for any position, you know, Congress, Senate, whatever she'd like to go forward with. Very intelligent, very understanding. That's something you need. Dan, you for 12 years, you ought to know. You have to listen to all your people that are.
You have to work with other government parties too. I try to work with the Park District. Pete Kokas was active in the Park District.
Oh yeah, Pete.
And with Lake County, Steve Mandel did a wonderful job.
Steve Mandel.
As our representative on the Lake County Board, he's going to retire in December. He's not running again. And many others, our congressmen, going back to McClory, and our senators, going back to Alan Dixon. I work with both parties because government has to cooperate. One problem with Illinois is we do have too many local government taxing districts. We could save money by combining, like say, the mosquito abatement district. That could be taken over by the cities or the county health department.
Well, why don't they do that then?
Well, people like the status quo. A township that's completely incorporated like ours, even though we've had Moraine Township, even though we've had some very fine supervisors, those services can be taken over by Highland Park, Highwood, Deerfield, whatever is in Moraine Township.
Yeah.
And the same is true of West Deerfield Township. But people somehow like, even though it's not cost efficient all the time, somehow like their units of local government. One of the few real regional units of local government we have is our North Shore Water Reclamation District, which starts at Lake Cook Road and runs up the Wisconsin line. We serve that entire area.
We serve Wisconsin. Illinois Water serves Wisconsin.
No, it's the Wisconsin line.
Oh, Wisconsin
north of
line.
Zion at Winthrop Harbor.
Okay.
From the Wisconsin line to the Cook County line.
Okay.
And that's where we. So we're regional, and that was created.
We don't sell
101 years ago.
Who do we sell our water to? Just
Highland Illinois? Park. Highland Park sells water to Deerfield, to Bannockburn, and to Lincolnshire, and a small piece of Northfield Township, and to Fort Sheridan. Highwood has its own water plant, and so does Lake Forest. But Highland Park City Water, Park Avenue down there, that serves all of Deerfield, all of Bannockburn, some of Riverwoods, and all of Lincolnshire.
Highland Park isn't looking to expand their...
Well, we just expanded, so we're looking someday Highwood's plant, which is aging. It's still working, it's still safe, but it's aging.
And?
Someday the Highwood water system may be taken over by Highland Park Water.
Oh.
Just as this year the people of Highwood voted in the Highland Park City Council for the Highwood Fire Department to be taken over and merged with the City of Highland Park.
Really?
Oh, yeah, end of this year, there'll be no more Highwood Fire Department.
I didn't know that.
Highland Park.
Oh, my.
Highland Park Fire Department. And as you know, we have a fairly new fire station on Half Day Road, not very far.
Beautiful station.
Not very far from Highwood.
Yeah, beautiful station.
And that's where
station.
The calls will come from. And so...
What then happens to those... trucks, cars, the equipment,
Some of the equipment will be taken over by Highland Park. Some of the firemen will retire.
Oh.
It used to be a volunteer fire department. Not now it's professional, but it just so happens that most of the members there are ready to retire or go on to something else. So maybe, or maybe someone will go to work for Highland Park. But I believe it's the end of this year. It was voted on in the March primary by Highwood to eliminate their fire department and merge with Highland Park. That makes sense.
But is supposed to be cost effective. Is
sure,
that what
you don't have
do?
Two chiefs. You don't have kinds of administration separate. You know, in Highland Park years ago, it was very controversial. I supported it, and a lot of people didn't like it. We merged our three grade school districts.
Yeah, I remember.
And it was controversial. I said in 3 or 4 years, people won't remember we had three districts, and now they don't.
Well,
we had 107, 108, 110.
Yeah, that's right. 111, sure.
Yeah, well,
yeah 111, because we're 111, yeah.
And high school districts
after being here 40 years, believe me, I have a little knowledge of what
now, what did that do? One superintendent instead of three superintendents?
Yeah.
One assistant superintendent or two instead of four assistant superintendents allowed for broader programs.
Yeah.
And it's really the way it should be. Deerfield, before that, combined their two elementary districts. They had 109 and 110.
Yeah.
And they merged those. They all feed into Highland Park or Deerfield High School, but that's the same district. Highland Park and Deerfield High School, although they have their own principals, have one superintendent, one group of assistant superintendents.
So the really with the combining of the junior high schools or the elementary schools, who determines what amount goes to Highland Park and what amount, is it how many of the students or just?
It's not separate now,
it's just
so much per student, whether they go to the brand new school we built in Highwood on half day, on half prairie or half day road there.
Yep.
Beautiful, a beautiful school.
Yep.
That serves Fort Sheridan and Highwood.
But what about bus service? What about transportation? How do the kids get there?
It's all one district.
Everybody one district. So you could really choose then. Does it make a difference? If you live further east, you can go.
Well, they try to keep you in your closest to your school.
Yeah.
Like people in the Highlands still have Northwood Junior High School, Middle High School, and they have Wayne Thomas Elementary School.
So they would still go to Highland
they
Park.
Do, Highland Park High School. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And the Highwood people at the new Oak Terrace School.
Oh yeah, that's beautiful.
They go to Northwood for their middle school.
Yeah.
As they always
do. So they come this way. They come.
Then they go to Highland Park High School.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's one integrated system on it. So when the Highland Park High School gets the eighth graders coming, they won't have had three different types of eighth grade education.
Okay.
It'll be one eighth grade district.
Yeah.
And it'll be unified. And some people thought, oh, that's not good. Well, it's worked out because we're really, we're not so big that we need different school districts within our
And you know, I think, I don't know.
That was historical.
Yeah, that is a historical moment. But the amount of students, Dan, have we run amok with, you know, providing more than what we have as far as students to be able to, I mean.
No, we can only have students that live here, and the school population has not grown in Highland Park. If you haven't noticed, we've become a slightly older community.
Oh, well, I've noticed. I do look in the mirror. Thank you very much.
But basically, our student population is not growing. It's hard to predict the future, but in fact, they overbuilt it one time. They had the Kennedy School, that's now a social service agency, on Clavey and Green Bay.
Oh, yeah.
They had a Westridge School, that's now the Park District headquarters.
Yeah.
They once had Green Bay Road School, which is now headquarters of the school district.
Yeah.
So they overbuilt it one time. Some schools are getting older. Most people will agree Lincoln School is getting older, and now you have to have schools up to date with all kinds of computer equipment
for the kids
and all that.
Right.
Now, there was a big issue in the primary that people, by 2-1 majority, thought it was too expensive a project and not enough towards neighborhood school, preserving neighborhood schools.
And what happened?
Well, the the issue referendum, lost 2-1.
Referendum lost.
There'll probably be future issues, but so the people do have a say, and they spoke loudly and said, too big, too costly, and also we love our
neighborhood schools, because the kids can kids can walk. They walk to school, take their bikes to school.
I hope they walk to school.
Instead of being bused.
I see as soon as it gets cloudy, though, some kids get rides to school these days. Not like when we were young.
Oh, right. Walk 5 miles in the snow. How many times have I heard this story? Yeah. Oh, my God.
Not many people did that, but I was in school during the World War II years, and there wasn't much gasoline, 3 gallons a week, and so kids rode their bikes to a 7th and 6th, 7th, 8th grade.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Now, I don't want to be unfair to the younger generation, but I do notice as soon as the weather forecast said there might be a little shower today, all the kids are getting rides to school.
Well, everybody thinks they're a sugar cube and they're going to melt, you know. But
maybe that's unfair of me to say. It's just what I noticed. And luckily, I'm not running for office this year, so I can't lose.
Your opinion is more than welcome on my program anytime.
By 2 years from now, maybe they'll have forgotten what I said.
No, well, they don't know.
Well, but anyway, that's...
But the consideration for the people, the community, the children, I mean, we have kept up with everything, Dan. Everybody has kept up. We're not lagging behind.
And it's been at a cost. Well, we pay high real estate taxes. I got my tax bill today.
Oh, you did?
When you get home, you'll probably find yours.
I don't even mention it. I don't even want to know about it. But I know the taxes are exorbitant.
Property taxes
really are
high. Luckily, we can still deduct them on our federal income tax, but it's an itemized deduction. But that's only a third of them.
I know, but the taxes are high. But the public, I mean, you know, some people really they like to be here. They enjoy being here. Some drive up from Chicago. I have another friend who was a teacher for 45 years in Chicago, and she drives up here just to be in the northern suburbs to Highland Park. She likes the food. She likes the clothing line. She likes the atmosphere. We exude some kind of atmosphere, and I don't know how to express that.
Well, it's called the Ravinia Festival.
Ravinia, absolutely, absolutely.
And we have an art movie theater, plays foreign and art films. We have some interesting stores, some small, some larger.
Yeah.
And people like even the Ravinia shopping area. They like to eat there or go
the bistro,
have coffee.
You like that? Yes, yes.
Or go to tea house, whatever they have.
Yeah.
And it's been a good thing on Skokie Highway. There are a lot of businesses, the old Skokie Highway below.
Yes,
car rentals and so on. So
it's Highland Park, I mean, of the other suburbs, the northern suburbs, Lake Forest is beautiful. Their schools are outstanding. The schools look like mansions. They have a lot of kids that go there. I mean, I attended a school function there and was there with the school board there. And these parents are very interested in the education of their children.
Sure.
And they're going to China, and they're going all over for education. These kids are going. Dan, this is, you know, we want to give our kids the best we could possibly teach them, because they're going to need it in life. This is the 21st century. We're already 16 years into the 21st
century. Hard to believe,
isn't
it?
I'm telling you, it's incredible. And, you know, my son was born when they went to the moon.
Yeah.
And so that we thought was miraculous to begin with. And look how we've progressed. And people that have passed away, if medical science would have known then what they know now, look how we have progressed. And Highland Park is moving right along with
it. Our hospital is wonderful.
Yes.
It's kept up to date.
Absolutely.
We're so lucky to have a general hospital of Highland Park quality right here. Many towns don't have that. Deerfield doesn't have a hospital.
No, this is a major medical center, Highland Park Hospital is a major medical center.
And they kept it that way, again, by mergers.
Yep.
They merged with Evanston.
Yep.
And the North Shore University Healthcare
yep,
System.
That's right.
There's been a loss of personal attention, maybe by the new hospital system, but still it's a wonderful facility. And they kept the equipment up to date. They've kept their cancer treatment up to date. And everything is terrific.
Well, their doctors are learned and experienced.
They are good.
And experienced. And you don't play around with human life. You don't want to lose that. We don't come back again. It's a one-time, one path. That's the way
yeah,
it goes.
Yeah, we'll find out.
Yeah, we'll find out.
Anyway, I was on the board of Highland Park Hospital for many years and still in their foundation. And I was always impressed by the quality, not only of the doctors, but the administrators are good too.
Administration yeah.
of the hospitals. Yep. So we're very fortunate, and our fire department provides great ambulance service. That's a city service.
That's true. Hey, and what
department.
About our Highland Park Police Department?
The best.
Okay, you better know it. We're right here. We are right here in the Highland Park Police Department.
Yeah, Mike Bonamart made it that way, and our present chief has kept it that way.
Yes. Chief Paul Schaefer, absolutely. And they have wonderful men, there's sergeants and lieutenants, and Sergeant Mueller, wonderful
gentlemen. All professionals.
All professional. We're very happy that you're a part of Highland Park. And we're so ecstatic that you were able to join us this evening at North Shore Live Cooper's Corner. If you would like to see this program again, please contact us on YouTube. I have a YouTube. There it is right here. Woo! YouTube.com, North Shore Live, CC, Cooper's Corner. And you can see Dan Pierce every time because it goes all over the world.
And that's double jeopardy. You have to see me twice, right?
Well, listen,
I'm going to
push you as much as I possibly can. You should have brought Rhoda on. Next time, you got to bring Rhoda on. And we'll talk about...
We'll have Beauty and the Beast, right?
No, well, it's you're Beauty and handsome, not no Beast, absolutely not.
Well, I'm sure she's watching, and she's made my career possible, so...
That's good.
I'm a lucky guy.
You certainly are, absolutely. And Highland Park is lucky to have you around. We appreciate you very much, Dan.
And you keep up the good work.
Well, I'm
trying.
What
is it, 30 years now?
35.
35 years.
I know. It's a long time.
And over that period... You had, what, about seven children?
Seven children here in Highland Park. Everybody has had a little taste of Highland Park schools and everything, and they loved it. It was wonderful.
Thank you for your service.
Thank you for your service. I appreciate that. I'm part of the Ladies Auxiliary. And anyway, we want to thank you for allowing us in your home or place of business. Hope you enjoyed our program this evening. And see you next week on North Shore Live, Cooper's Corner. Have a pleasant evening. A very safe day, and enjoy the beautiful weather that we have. Thank you so much. Good evening.